Thank you. Merry Christmas. Every Lord's Day is special, but it's particularly good to be worshiping as a people to our God together the day before the arrival of our King. Amen. My name is Lauren Skinker. I'm the Director of Communications here at Cedar Crest, and our mission is to glorify the Triune God by exalting Him, edifying and equipping His church, and evangelizing the world with His gospel. If you're new here, we want to welcome you. Thank you for joining us. We'd like to get to know you better and find a way for you to further plug in here at Cedar Crest. And a great way to do that is to fill out one of these Connect cards, and they should be located on the pew rack in front of you. So if you fill that out, and then after the service, you can hand it in at the lobby on your way out, and we'll have a gift for you. But welcome, and thank you for joining us. Just a few housekeeping items. There is no children's church today. So the children will be joining us for the whole service this Sunday, and we're very happy about that. It'll be resuming next week, skyrocket and blast off. There will be children's church next week. And also family night. There's no family night this Wednesday. That will pick up again on Wednesday, January 3rd. If you didn't know, it's Christmas Eve, so now you do. Our Christmas Eve candlelight service is this evening at 6:30. So please join us for that. It's a special time of lighting the candles and singing Silent Night. We still have invite cards available at the promo table out there by the vision wall or at the welcome desk. Feel free to grab those on your way out to invite family, friends, neighbors. It's a great outreach opportunity to invite people to our Christmas Eve candlelight service tonight, and that's at 6:30 p.m. And just a further reminder, there is no service tomorrow, Christmas Day, just to clarify. And finally, our registration for the winter trimester of Discipleship Institute is officially open. For those who might be unfamiliar with DI or just new to Cedar Crest, DI is our version of Sunday school, and it's where we offer doctrinally rich and immensely practical classes on theology, Christian living, and more. So you can go sign up for one of those classes at cedarcrest.church/DI online. And instead of me describing each of those courses to you, I'm going to have the teachers do so in their own words with a short video that we have for you guys.
We trust and believe in Jesus Christ, and now we belong to the family of God. But then what? We know a lot about people and have casual relationships. However, oftentimes, unless it is something formally done in the church, we miss the everyday opportunities to come alongside, bear one another's burdens, stir each other up to love and good works. So this class, the instrument in the Redeemer's hands, is designed to help you and I grow in our relationship with Christ so that we can also help others grow in their walk with the Lord. We are not just going to know more about Scripture, but we're going to be living out our part of God's redemptive story that we read in Scripture and that is still happening today. I hope you will join me as we grow in the grace and knowledge of God together.
Hi, I'm Rick Whitmire. I'm one of the elders here at Cedar Crest Bible Fellowship Church. Maybe you were like me, and as a kid, you thought, where are my prayers actually going? Are they bouncing off the ceiling? Is God really hearing them? But we have the promises that Jesus is interceding on our behalf. And the Holy Spirit interprets our groans when we are too weak to pray. Prayer is a vital part of a Christian's life. And it is something that we often overlook and we don't tap into. My goal in this class, which is going to be 6 weeks of study on prayer and then 6 weeks of focused prayer together as a community, is for us to fall in love with this gift of God and arm ourselves for the battle that is ahead.
Hello, my name is Dan Waterman, and I am one of the elders here at Cedar Crest Bible Fellowship Church. I have the opportunity to teach this coming semester a course called How to Understand the Bible. You know, when you read the New Testament epistles, one of the major themes you encounter is a strong warning about false teachers in the church. The Apostle Paul in particular warned the readers of his letters to be on the lookout for those from within the church who would distort the gospel of Jesus Christ. One of the goals of Cedar Crest Bible Fellowship Church is to equip our members to be diligent students of God's Word, who remain faithful to the truth of Scripture. We want to be a local church that does its best to present ourselves to God as one approved, rightly handling the Word of Truth.
I'm Jennifer Mehta. I am the Women's Group Facilitator for the How to Understand the Bible class. Through the use of proven methods and resources, such as the Simeon Trust, we want to help individuals become better students of the Bible so that no one will distort the gospel or wander into vain discussions. So whether you seek to teach others or simply want to become a better Bible student, we encourage you to join us in How to Understand the Bible.
A well-known pastor once said that local church membership is a question of biblical obedience, not personal preference. Membership is one of our church, Cedar Crest's core values. We think it's that important because Scripture treats it as such. Our desire is not to be a gathering of Christians that come and go as we please without commitment or accountability, but to be a church in every biblical sense of the word. We want everyone who sits in our pews and who serves or is served by our people to covenant together with us in church membership. In order for this relationship to work, you need to know us and we need to know you. In this course, we will seek to do just that. We share our view of the gospel, the most important thing about us, our view of the church, our theology, our values, explain why and how you should join a local church, and much more. By the end of this course, we hope that you will commit to becoming a member here at Cedar Crest.
Good morning. If you're able, I invite you to stand with us. We're going to begin our time of worship and song. I'm going to start by reading some scripture for us from Luke chapter 1. It says, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers, and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him in all our days." Let's sing and worship our Lord, serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness this day and all of our days. So you call the sun.
You call the sun to rise. You lay it down to rest. You hold this heart of mine. You hold my every breath. Such an awesome God, so mighty, so holy, so wonderful, such an awesome God, so selfless, so generous, so faithful you are. Seated in majesty, reigning in holy, for me, you are the living bread, such an awesome God, so mighty, so holy, so wonderful, such an awesome God, so selfless, so generous, so faithful, and nothing comes close. to the Lord. Almighty, nothing as sweet as His love and mercy, nothing comes close to the Lord. Almighty, nothing as sweet as His love and mercy, nothing comes close to the Lord. Almighty, nothing as sweet as Your love. Son of God hung on a cross to die. Not even death itself could hold you down, for you rose to life. Such an awesome God, so such an awesome God, so selfless, so generous, so faithful You
Isaiah 57, verse 15, we read this. For thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. He says this, I dwell in the high and holy place, and also with him who is of a contrite and lowly spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly, to revive the heart of the contrite. Let's continue to sing. and
The wondrous gift is given, so God imparts to human hearts the blessings of His hand. No ear may hear His coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive Him still, the dear Christ enters in. Oh, holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us,
child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring Him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring Him incense, gold, and myrrh, come peasant king to own Him, the King of kings salvation brings, then loving hearts enthrone Him. Raise, raise the song on high, the virgin sings her lullaby. Joy, joy, for Christ is born, the babe, the Son of Mary. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring Him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. Nail, spear shall pierce Him through, the cross He bore for me, for you. Hail, hail, the Word made flesh, the babe, the Son of Mary.
Galatians 4, 4 through 7. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth His Son, born of a woman, under the law to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God.
Thank you.
all-sufficient Mary, shining like the sun. A fortune I inherit by no work I have done. My righteousness I forfeit at my Savior's cross, where all-sufficient Mary did what I could not. In love he condescended, eternal now in time. A life without a blemish, the Maker made to die. The law could never save us, our love is this at one. Until the pure and spotless Lamb hath finally crowned. It is done, it is finished. No more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient.
Oh, sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains.
God in the highest. You may be seated.
Merry Christmas, Cedar Crest family and guests. In keeping with reading from a prophecy from Luke, we want to read Luke 1, 46 through 55, Mary's Magnificat, and then we'll pray from that. Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name, and his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever." Let's pray. Father, this morning we exalt you. That is the primary purpose that we exist as a people, as a church, to exalt and glorify you, the Triune God, Father, Son, and Spirit. Lord, we thank you that you have saved us from our sin through sending your dear Son into the world to take our sin on himself and to live the perfect life that we were required to live, to die on a cross, paying the penalty, canceling the record of debt that stood against us with all of its demands, nailing it to the cross, so that we might believe, because on the third day he rose again. Lord, may we not celebrate Christmas outside the context of all that Christ has come to do. Lord, I thank you that you have looked on the humble and the lowly of heart, the crushed, and have been merciful to us. We thank you that you tear down the proud. We thank you that some of the proud you humble so that they might know you. But Lord, all the proud who is against you and your people, you will one day gain victory over. We thank you that you are a covenant-keeping God according to this text, that you keep all of your promises. You promised in the garden in Genesis 3:15 that the seed of the woman would crush the head of the serpent, and you fulfilled that promise. Jesus, Abraham's true offspring, we worship you. We thank you. Lord, as your people, we thank you that you have preserved us, that you have kept us. And Lord, there are many of your people here that are suffering, that are grieving, that are hurting. And I pray, God, this Christmas season that you would give grace to your people who are hurting. To those who are rejoicing, Lord, may we rejoice in the right things, and may we not lose sight of those who are grieving in our midst. Father, may we minister to one another as a body as you've called us to do. Father, I pray this morning if there's any guests in this room who do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, who have only known him, Lord, as a commercialized Savior, that today would be the day that they would hear who Christ is and all that he is, and they would turn from their sin and trust in this Jesus, the one who died and conquered death and conquered sin and who lives forevermore. Father, I lift up to you our missionaries, Barry and Candace Wingo, who have given their lives to that cause. Lord, in this new season, ministering to those who are on home assignment, give them grace. May they, Lord, have the wisdom and the counsel to bless other missionaries with, and would you, Lord, guard them from the evil one, we pray. Lord, we lift up to you Catherine Helfrich, who can no longer gather with us. We pray that you would give her grace this time of year and be her portion and her cup. And Father, I lift up to you Christelle Yuja, our college student of the week. Lord, I thank you for her relationship with you. I pray, Lord, that you would keep her faithful to Jesus as she studies at DeSales. And Lord, help her, Father, to enter into the next semester, Lord, with just great confidence in you, trust in you, and that she would maintain her walk with you and be diligent in her studies. Father, we also lift up to you now the preaching of your word. We thank you, God, that it is your word, that your spirit through your word conforms us, your people, more and more into the likeness of Jesus Christ. I pray for my brother Jason that you would give him the words that you want him to say, that you would empower him with your spirit, for apart from your spirit, he can do nothing. And so I just pray that you would give him grace, God. May we be listeners of the word and not hearers only. May we apply this to our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. A friendly reminder, the kids are not dismissed to Children's Church.
Thank you, brother. Speaking of kids, Merry Christmas, everybody. While I ask the kids a question, the rest of you turn in your Bibles to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. But to begin our time together, I want to ask the children if they recognize this phrase. You ready? With great power comes great responsibility. Who said that? Spider-Man. Come on, kiddos. It's my son's favorite Marvel character. Uncle Ben said that to Spider-Man. Spider-Man is one of my son's favorite heroes. And that's because he can do amazing things, right? He can swing from building to building, and he can stop a blazing, fast-moving train from going off the railroad tracks that were destroyed, right? I mean, this guy's amazing. He can defeat any dastardly villain that's on the planet. And yet, who's underneath that suit? What's his name? Peter Parker. Little skinny teenager from Brooklyn, right? He walks around with his high tops and chews bubble gum. He looks like any normal human being. But when he puts that suit on, look out, it's Spider-Man. Now, as amazing as that is, I almost said really is, but it's not really, because, children, that's fantasy. That's fake. It's fun to watch on your TV screen. But this morning, I want to tell you about somebody who is absolutely real, who is infinitely stronger than Spider-Man, and did the opposite of what Spider-Man did. Because he looked normal. He looked normal, and yet underneath that normal, he clothed his deity, his godness, with flesh and blood, like one of us. Who is that, children? Jesus. Jesus Christ. That's who we're going to look at this morning from Philippians chapter 2, one of the most majestic texts in all the Bible about the person and work of the Lord Jesus. And we're going to look at verses 5 through 8. Paul writes this, "Have this mind among yourselves." He's writing to the Philippian church, "which is yours in Christ Jesus." Now listen carefully. "Who, though he was in the form of God," This is incredible. Did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. This is incredible. Brothers and sisters and children, this is incredible. This is the most amazing thing that has ever happened in the history of this world. That the one who made the world, we just sang about it, the one who created everything and everyone in the world will lower himself, stoop way down to serve us, to serve and to save us. And how does he do it? He takes on the form of a servant and he takes on the form of a man. It's incredible. And he looks ordinary. He looks so normal, which is why the people around him in the Gospels thought this way, like the disciple Peter. He would say to Jesus, if you remember this account, after Jesus told him, Peter, put your net out for a catch of fish. And yet Peter says, Master, we fished all night long and we didn't catch a thing. Now I'm only imagining that Peter in his mind is saying to himself, what does this ordinary man teacher know about fishing? What does he know about fishing? Until he did as his master said, and he lowered the nets down into the water, it says in Luke 5, and they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. And they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. And all of a sudden, in Peter's mind and heart, because the Father is revealing to him who this man really is, he fell down at Jesus' knees and he said, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. O Lord. But he looks like a simple, normal human being. Which is why the disciples were blown away again in Matthew chapter 8 when a great storm arose on the sea, it says, and they were all in the boat, and the boat was being swamped by the waves. And where is Jesus? Asleep. Asleep. But when they woke him up, it says, he rose and rebuked the winds and the waves, and there was a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, what sort of, can you say it, finish it? Man is this. What sort of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? He's just a man. Look at him. Look at him. He sleeps like a man. And yet the oceans obey him. Isn't this just the carpenter's son? That's what his hometown friends would say. The son of Joseph and Mary. Are the sisters and brothers with us? And they took offense at him. The question they should have been asking is this. Who is this really? Who is this man? It's the most important question in the universe, gang. This is not a Marvel comic book. This is not a character that somebody has made up. This is somebody that eyewitnesses saw right before their very eyes, and they wrote it down for us in the scriptures. And there is nobody, to my knowledge, who was around in that day and wrote down, no, Jesus never existed, nor did he ever do these miracles or die on a cross. Matter of fact, even the Jewish historian Josephus, who was not a believer, he was around in that day, and he wrote about Jesus, who claimed to be the Messiah, who was a great teacher, was killed by Pontius Pilate. Same testimony we have in the New Testament. So here's the reality, gang. This man did exist. He did exist. And this man did all of the things that the Bible says he did. And so that begs the same question that he asked his disciples at one point in time. He said to them, "Who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am?" It's the most important question ever in the universe, and the most important question that you have to answer. You have to answer for yourself. How you answer this will determine your destiny. Well, this morning, the Apostle Paul, who was an anti-Christian, fanatic, turned Christian, he's going to tell us who this man really is and what he has done for us in humble obedience to God. And again, this should blow our minds. This should blow our minds because of how far God went and stooped for us. This is why we love Christmas, isn't it? Chris prayed it. This is why we celebrate Christmas. This is the reason for the season. If you don't worship Jesus, I think one theologian just said, if you don't need a Savior, then you don't need Christmas. This text is incredible. It's called the Hymn of Christ, like we saw last week. Could have been considered a hymn of Christ that they might have sang. Because it captures everything about him, what makes him tick, how he thinks, which is a wonderful thing to ponder, because in the context of this passage, the Apostle Paul is imploring the Philippians to have the same mind, have the same mind and humility that Jesus does, verse 5. And then working backwards, this mindset is to serve one another in all humility, considering others' interests as well as your own. It's verse 4. Why? Because that's who our Jesus is. That's who he is. That's how he thinks. I love this. One person said, this is like reading his diary. We get a glimpse in how he thinks and what he wants to do. And what does he do? We're going to find out in this passage. God Almighty humbles himself to serve and to save us. Incredible humility in obedience to his Father, especially when you remember that Jesus is God. Look at verse 6. Who, speaking about the Lord Jesus, right before he says, who, though he was in the form of God. Or your version might say he existed in the form of God. Or another version says he was in the very nature God. They're all making the same point. Here's the point. Before Jesus ever came into the world and became a human being, he has always existed in the form of God. He was always the eternally pre-existent Son of God, who was there in the beginning. We went over this verse in John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, because he was already there. And then in verse 3, it talks about him making the whole world, echoing Genesis 1. In the beginning, God. Well, guess who was there? God the Father, God the Son. Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Face to face. Toward one another for all of eternity. And the Word was God. God in the form of God. Morphe, that's the word. It means to manifest the essence of who somebody really is. And in this case, Jesus was in the form of God before he was born in Bethlehem. So here's where my mind goes to the Old Testament, before he was born in Bethlehem, and I read about one who was walking in the garden with Adam and Eve. Who do I think that is? Yeah, Jesus, the pre-incarnate Jesus. Do you know, in the Old Testament, that there was a man who appeared to Abraham, and there was a man who wrestled with Jacob, And do you know what that man said to Jacob afterwards? You have striven with God. You want to know who that was? That was Jesus. Not fully flesh and blood. He's appearing in the form of a man. That's Jesus. Nobody's ever seen God the Father, is what Jesus means when he comes and says that. But anytime you read about God appearing, and sometimes it's angel, the angel of the Lord in the Old Testament, met Samson's parents. Who is that? That is the pre-incarnate Lord Jesus Christ, who was in the form of God. Don't believe me? How about the burning bush? Moses says to the burning bush, after the burning bush, God says to him, I'm sending you to Egypt to rescue my people. And he says, who should I tell him sent me? And what did God say? Tell him I am sent you. And then fast forward a few thousand years to the Lord Jesus standing in front of the Pharisees, talking about Abraham. And he says to them, Abraham saw my day and was glad. But all they see is a human. You're not yet 50 years old. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. They knew what he was claiming. They tried to kill him. You're claiming to be God of the burning bush. This is incredible, gang. This is the point that Paul's making. Before he came to this earth and was born, he was in the form of God. Now, I don't want you to be confused by the word was or existed. Like it's just a past tense kind of a thing, and now it's over when he becomes a man. Like he doesn't have this form anymore. This is what the false teachers teach, but that is not correct. That's why I love Greek. It's not in the past tense. In the original language, it means to continue on in that form that you have always had, that you previously had in existence. So it means Jesus remains the same as he always was in the form of God. And that's going to be super important as we go through this text. But here, Paul is just making the point that Jesus eternally existed as God before he took on humanity. He was in the form of God because he is God. And next, because he is in the form of God, he is equal with God. He's equal with God, Paul says next. Look at the text, the second half of verse 6. It says he was in the form of God, but he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. Now, what in the world does that mean? There's a lot of controversy over this phrase, and I don't think there has to be if you read it carefully. And when you read it carefully, what do you find? First, this is beautiful. Jesus counted or considered. He was considering this. I love this. He's considering this move that he's about to make very carefully. That means he's fixing his mind to do this. That's what counting or considering means. And what was he not considering? His equality with God, Paul says next. That means he was equal with God. That's what he says. That's what it means. I don't care what the false teachers try to tell you. This means what it says. He's equal with God because he's God himself. We just heard the Apostle Paul say that. And so the next question, if Jesus is God, who is equality with God talking about? Another God? It's a good question. It's not another God. It's a reference to the Trinity. One God in three persons and three persons in one God. He's talking about his Father. He's talking about his Father. He's considering how he is equal with his Father. He's the same as his Father in every way, in power and glory and essence as God the Son. So please don't ever let any false teacher or cult tell you that Jesus is not equal to God or equal with the Father. It says he is right here. Even though, I think this is important, Jesus will say things like this when he becomes a man. the Father is greater than I. I got into an argument with a Jehovah's Witness over this one. Let me tell you what that means. All that means is that the Father has greater authority in our relationship right now because I am a human. I descended into humanity, and He sends me all of His commands and everything that He wants me to do, which is what I want to obey. But that does not mean that Jesus is inferior to the Father in His godness in any way. In fact, in Jesus' high priestly prayer in John 17, He prayed that the Father would glorify Him in His presence again. Again. After He dies and rises from the dead and ascends back to heaven as the God-man, He says, "Give me the glory that I had with you before the world existed, when I was in the form of God without a human body, equal with God in heaven, still am, even though He took on humanity." Gang, this is why the religious leaders of His day would stone Him for making Himself equal with God. It's John 5. After Jesus said, "I do the works that my Father does," what's He claiming? He's my Father and I'm just like Him. I have the same essence. And He's working and I do the same works. He's claiming to be God. That's why they wanted to stone Him, for blasphemy. And so, what do we have in this moment? Jesus is not considering or counting this equality with God in some way, shape, or form that we're going to see next, that He had in heaven before He came to earth. And I'm trying to imagine what that was like for Him in glory. And we get a glimpse of Jesus in heaven when the prophet Isaiah said in Isaiah 6, "In the year the king Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of His robe filled the temple." Do you see it? See it? The eyes of your heart? "Above Him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two He covered His face, and with two He covered His feet, and with two He flew. And one called to another and said, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of His glory.' And the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of Him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, 'Woe is me, I am lost. I am a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.'" Do you know that John the Apostle wrote about this moment in John chapter 12? When he wrote this, "Isaiah said these things because he saw His glory and spoke of Him." Whose glory? Jesus' glory. That's the pre-incarnate Christ, God. It's incredible. It's incredible. And yet, He fixes His mind on doing what we're about to see next. And so what does He do? He doesn't keep a hold of His divine privileges and rights as the Son of God in heaven. And so now, oh Lord Jesus, help us to believe this and to see this as it happened 2,000 years ago. He begins His descent to come to the earth. His humiliation, they call this the humiliation of the Son of God. This is what Paul means when he says, "Though He was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped." What does that mean? Not to grasp equality with God on Jesus' part as God. And again, there's been significant controversy over what this means, and I don't think there has to be. But here's why. Because some would say that this means Jesus never possessed equality with God, and so now He's trying to grasp that equality for Himself. kind of like Adam and Eve did when they wanted to be like God, or the devil who wanted to be like God, and that is absolutely dead wrong. Dead wrong. Jesus was not grasping for anything. Like he's trying to be equal with God. He's already in the form of God and equal with God. It cannot mean that. And so what does it mean? It means that he did not keep holding onto his equality with God in heaven as God himself, with all the rights and privileges of heaven that were already his to keep for his own benefit as God himself. And the question is why? Why? I tell you why. Because his mind is fixed on verse 7. It's fixed. Our Lord's mind is fixed on verse 7. Brothers and sisters, that should make us very, very thankful. Very thankful. Listen to me. Jesus Christ could have stayed. He could have stayed and rightfully done so. He could have told his Father, no way am I doing that. I am far too precious as God. I would be far too precious to take on human flesh and shed my precious blood for those rebels. I will not do it. I will not do it. And yet that's the opposite of what our Lord said to the Father. Praise him. Praise him. He became one of the humblest servants this world has ever seen, emptying himself of those privileges that he had as the Son of God. Look at what Paul says in the beginning of verse 7. He made himself nothing. Nothing. That blows my mind. The God of the universe who made all things made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant. Now again, this is where theologians got it wrong in the 1800s. Make yourself nothing. It could be translated, if you have the NASB, as emptying yourself. And so what did they do? They read this and they say to themselves, well, if he's emptying himself, that means he must be emptying himself of deity. That's what they said. Some would say that he became less than God when he made himself nothing. Or he gave up some of his divine attributes when he made himself nothing. Paul is not saying that. He never said that Jesus gave up being in the form of God or stopped being equal with God. I explained it earlier. That word was existed means he's always existed. He's not going to take it off. He's going to continue in the very form that he always was. It's interesting. Again, this is why the original language is very important. Paul's the only one to use this word. The only one. And this word does relate to another word that means to empty yourself of the stuff that you really are. But Paul doesn't use that word. He uses another word that means to pour yourself out. But that doesn't mean that he poured his deity out. Like he left his deity behind, got rid of it. That goes against what Paul just said. It goes against what the New Testament says everywhere, that Jesus is the exact image of the invisible God, that the fullness of God dwells bodily in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so again, what does it mean when it says here he emptied himself and made himself nothing and poured himself out? It simply means what Paul is going to say. He left his glory in heaven and he's going to take on the form of a servant and the form of a man. That's all it means. It doesn't mean that he left his deity behind. Does that make sense? You all hear me? You better nod your heads. Do you believe it? You better believe it. If you don't believe it, don't walk out of here until you talk to me. Hear this. This is not subtraction. This is not transforming from God to a servant, from God to a man. This is adding on to who he already is. That's an incredible too. He added on the form of a servant. The form of a servant. That literally means a bondservant or a slave. A slave. Let that blow your mind. Again, this is Jesus Christ, who in the form of God was there in the beginning, that the Father made the world through, the one who sustains the universe by the word of his power. took on the form. It's the word again, form. You see that number of times. Form. He took on the form. Added it to his godness, the very nature of a slave. He became a slave, just like he was in the form of God, totally and fully. Listen to this. He added onto his deity the full form of a servant. He did not transform from God into a slave. He added the form of a slave, which means he took it on fully, not partially, not temporarily, like putting on some kind of slave's garment for a time, and then took it off. No, this means literally he became a slave and a bondservant forever. Let that blow your mind. The God of the universe became a slave and a bondservant forever. Forever. We see it firsthand when he came, but we also see it when he went back. What's he doing right now as I speak? He's serving us by praying for us. That's our Jesus. It's our Jesus. This blows me away too, because this word, slave, literally means you will be owned by somebody else. Now, we all know that the Lord Jesus is not owned by anybody in this world, save his submission to the Father when he was here. And to do his will. And what was his will? To become a servant. Servant. We see it all over the Bible. We see our Lord Jesus. What's he doing? Serving, 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 teaching, healing. It's incredible. Going, serving, serving. This is mine. He took it on. Praise God. Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. It says in Matthew 20:28. So he took on the form of a servant. And what does that form look like? What did he take on? The form of a man. End of verse 7. Taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. Brothers and sisters, friends, children, this is what we have in the manger. This is God Almighty, Lord of heaven and earth. The maker of the very ground you walk on, and the maker of every hair that's on your head, whose spirit was put into the womb of the Virgin Mary by the Holy Spirit, we're told in the Gospel of Luke, and given a human body and a human nature. It's incredible. Combined with Jesus' divinity and that little baby lying in a manger. That's Emmanuel. It's Emmanuel, which means God with us. Being born literally means to become and exist in this state. And what state is that? The likeness of men, Paul says. The likeness of men. Fully, completely. This isn't just appearing. Some false teachers out there, he just appeared that way. He looked like a man, but he wasn't really a man. The word likeness means to be made like a man in every way. This is not a clone. This is not a disguise. This is not the ghost of a man. He was made like us in every way. Hebrews 2:17. He was made like his brothers in every single way. Let this blow your mind, brothers and sisters. God was made like us in every single way. Jesus was made like us in every single way. It's incredible. Don't try to figure out how he is fully God and fully man. Your brain will hurt. But we believe it in the one person is fullness of deity and fully a man. This is why he can sleep in a boat during a storm, because he's dog tired. And then get woken up and just go to the wind and the waves and say, "Peace, be still." Who is this? It's fully God, fully man. It's incredible. Only him. Only him ever in the history of the world claimed to be God in the flesh. And only him healed the deaf and the blind and raised the dead and cast out demons and forgave sins that only God can do. Only Jesus, because he is Emmanuel. Nobody else. Nobody else. Just Jesus. And so we see him. We celebrated Christmas, now born as a little baby in a manger, grows up as a toddler. Wouldn't you like to have him as a toddler, parents? You never had to spank him, probably. Teenager, fully grown as a human man, Paul says he was found in human form. So there it is again. Christ, fully God, takes on human form. In every way that his divinity is clothed and robed in his humanity, sometimes he let that out like it is transfiguration. But many times he did not, gang, and he looked so human that not even his brothers believed in him. We read in John 7:5. He was so human that the religious leaders thought he was blaspheming when he claimed to be one with the Father. "We're going to stone you for blasphemy," they said, "because you, being a mere man, make yourself God." John 10:33. Again, he was so human that the people who watched him grow up, they could not believe he was from heaven. "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know?" John 6. "How can he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" There's no way he came down from heaven. There's no way. We watched him grow up just like every other normal kid. We know his parents. We know his brothers and sisters. He's just a man. Boy, was Isaiah right 700 years prior in chapter 53 when he writes about Jesus walking the earth as a man. "He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men." Why? Because God was so humble, he took on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. The infinite taking on the finite, limiting himself. The all-powerful, divine, taking on humanity. The creator clothing himself with creation. That's as humble as you can get. I love what one person said. "Look at him. Look at him, this amazing Jesus. Look at him. He's helping Joseph make a yoke in the carpenter's shop. And yet this is the one who could far more easily make a solar system. Look at him. Dressed like a slave with a towel and basin and bathing the feet of his disciples." Because he took on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And as we watch his life, as we move on to this next part of obedience, as we watch his life, he obeyed the Father in every way, at all times. It's incredible. Never disobeyed him, even one time. And it's not like when times got hard and the cross is looming that he stopped. He did not stop. He continued to obey to the point where he would give up his life. This is why our master is so great. He didn't serve for a time and then leave it all behind. He didn't choose another path. Do you realize that our eternity is secure because he did not choose another path? Do you realize that, yes, the Father wanted him to do this, but he willingly gave up his life? He said, "Nobody takes my life from me." That's what Jesus said. "I lay it down." Our Lord Jesus did this willingly. He set his mind when he was above to take on the form of a servant, take on the form of a man, so he could serve and save us and obey his Father. End of verse 8. This is why he made himself nothing and humbled himself. This is why he took on the form of a servant and humbled himself. This is why he became a baby in the manger and humbled himself. This is why he became a man and humbled himself. Paul says, being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. First reason you see here why he humbled himself and took on this form of a servant and the form of a man, it's because his Father wanted him to die. His Father, our Father, wanted him to die. Look at what Paul says again. He humbled himself and became obedient. And the question is, to who? To who? He's still the God-man. He's still equal with God. He does not have to listen to anybody. He could have preserved his life, but yet he did not. He became obedient willingly to his Father, even to the point of death, because his Father wanted him to die. That answers the question, who really did kill Jesus? Who really killed Jesus? Ultimately, it was the Father. It was the Father through the wicked hands of men, and what they meant for evil, God meant for good. But it was the will of the Lord to crush him. Isaiah 53. 700 years before this. And can you imagine the pair agreeing on this? My will is for you to get crushed. Bear their iniquity and their sins, my son. Jesus says, I will do it. I will do it. Even though he struggled the night before, you know this, in the Garden of Gethsemane. Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Not as I will, but you will. That's obedience to his Father in the highest degree, gang. This is the hardest thing any human being has ever had to face. And not just to die, any kind of death, but the most excruciating and humiliating way to ever die in the history of the world. Somebody said this is like a big exclamation point for Paul right now. Even death on a cross, he was willing to die the lowest imaginable way to die. They would not even crucify Roman criminals on a cross. And yet there hangs the Son of God, the maker of heaven and earth, our maker, the King of kings, the creator and sustainer of all things, who took on human flesh and blood in the person of Jesus Christ. And the answers are the questions, why would God ever do something like this, stoop so low, take on the form of a servant, the form of a human being, and die on a cross? The answer is, in obedience to his Father, to pay for our sins. Our sins. We needed a human being, a perfect one, who could be an acceptable sacrifice for our sins. And please don't tell me, anybody in here, say that I don't need this, because I'm not a sinner. Yes, you are. You've all lied or lusted. You've all been greedy. You've all been selfish. You have not obeyed God 100% your entire life and loved him 100% your entire life. That's what you need to get into heaven. If you could work your way there, Jesus wouldn't have had to come. But he did. To bear all of our sins upon himself. And so I want to read one of the most beautiful descriptions of this whole thing from the book called When God Weeps. This was written by Johnny Erickson Todd and her mentor, Stephen Estes. And I want you to listen to these words very, very carefully. As the man swings, the son recalls how he and the father first designed the medial nerve of the human forearm, the sensations it would be capable of. The design proves flawless. The nerve performs exquisitely. Up you go! They lift the cross. God is on display and can scarcely breathe. But these pains are a mere warm-up to his other and growing dread. He begins to feel a foreign sensation somewhere during this day. An unearthly foul odor began to waft, not around his nose, but around his heart. He feels dirty. Human wickedness starts to crawl upon his spotless being. And the apple of the father's eye turns brown with rot. His father, he must face his father like this. And from heaven, the father now rouses himself like a lion disturbed, shakes his mane, and roars against the shriveling remnant of a man hanging on a cross. Never has the son seen the father look at him like this. Never felt even the least of his hot breath. But the roar shakes the unseen world and darkens the visible sky. The son does not recognize these eyes. Son of man, why have you behaved so? You have cheated and lusted. You have stolen and gossiped. You have murdered and envied. You have hated and lied. You have cursed. You have robbed. You have overspent. You have overeaten. You have fornicated. You disobeyed. You embezzled and you have blasphemed. Oh, the duties you have shirked. The children you've abandoned. Who has ever so ignored the poor? So played the coward. So belittled my name. Have you ever held your razor tongue? What a self-righteous, pitiful drunk. Mock your parents. Who gave you the boldness to rig elections, foment revolutions, worship demons? Does the list never end? Splitting families, buying politicians, watching pornography, accepting bribes. I hate these things. I loathe these things in you. Disgust for everything about you consumes me. Can you not feel my wrath? The father watches as his heart's treasure, the mere image of himself, sinks drowning into raw liquid sin. Jehovah's stored rage against humankind from every century explodes in a single direction. Of course, the son is innocent. He's blamelessness itself. The father knows this, but the divine pair have an agreement, and the unthinkable must now take place. Jesus will be treated as if personally responsible for every sin we have ever committed, and he will pay it in full. Hallelujah, praise God. Are you with me? We sang it already. Jesus took on every single one of those sins, every single sin that you have ever committed, past, present, future. He took it on himself, and the Father poured out his full fury and wrath onto him. And it's gone. It's gone. It's gone. Sins are gone. Sins are forgiven. Wrath is gone. It turns to forgiveness. Full forgiveness and full acceptance from the Father. This is why he died on the cross. Amen? To become a curse for us so that we may become rich in Jesus. Praise him. Praise him. I pray you know this Jesus. If your conscience is disturbing you right now because of sin, run. Run to him. Trust him that he did this for you. And commit to following him. That's why he came at Christmas time. Amen? Father, we come before you. And we praise you. It was your idea to send the Son, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. It was your idea. Even though we rebelled, we loved darkness, we didn't love you, we wanted to be God, we want to live our own way. We commit cosmic treason against you all the time. As our creator, and yet you and your wonderful, glorious, tremendous mercy sent your son into the world. And I'm so glad, Jesus, that you were willing to leave heaven's glory and to descend so low to earth and take on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form. Becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross, to save and to serve us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for doing what you have done. And I pray that there is not a soul in this room that doesn't know you personally and trust in what you have done for us I pray for them to embrace you, to trust that you have taken their sins away and the Father's wrath away, and that you will give them your perfection so that they can go to heaven and be with you forever. I pray that they would turn to you and change their mind from this world and set their mind on you. Would you do that work, I ask, in Jesus' name and for your glory. And all of God's people said, amen.
If you're able, would you stand with us as we sing?
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I can't but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have been my ransom.
It was my sin.
It was my sin that held Him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished.
And it is finished. It is finished. Merry Christmas. Kiddos, I know you're in the room. Parents, you can quote it with me. The most popular verse in the world is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That's the gospel. God the Father. God the Father. That's who Jesus is talking about. Loved this world, and He so loved this world. He's not an unfeeling, far away, stoic God. He is a God who loves. And He loves so much, He gave His most precious personal possession, his son, for God so loved the world. I love what one theologian said. Man, what blows me away is that God loved the world, not because the world's so big, but because the world's so bad. So loved the world that he gave his one and only son, his precious, unique son, that whoever believes, and gang, that is not a belief that is just intellectual, that you know some facts about Jesus. This is saving belief, that you trust in him and what he did for you on the cross, and you turn your mind and your life away from the world and you commit to following this Jesus. And why? Because then you will receive eternal life. And you will live forever in glory in heaven with him instead of perishing. That's a reality. So I pray as you leave today, if you do not know the Son of God who died for you, I want you to come and talk with me. We're going to have prayer counselors down here who will talk with you as well and who will pray with you. Do not leave today without doing business with God. Today's the day of salvation. Father, we come before you. Thank you for this most precious, indescribable gift, the gift of your Son coming from heaven, taking on flesh and blood, and paying the penalty for our sins. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done. And we will worship you. Oh, we will worship you this Christmas better and harder than we ever have before. And all of God's people said, amen. Love you. See you tonight, not tomorrow. Tonight.
Hi, my name is Pastor Jason Hoy. We're so